गुड इवनिंग एवरी वन. टुडे वी आर स्टार्टिंग विद अ न्यू चैप्टर इन ज्योग्राफी, दैट इज ट्रांसपोर्ट इन इंडिया. वी हैव कंप्लीटेड वाटर रिसोर्सेज, दैट इज द फर्स्ट चैप्टर, एंड टुडे दिस इज द सेकेंड चैप्टर. टुडे बिफोर स्टार्टिंग आई लाइक टू एक्सप्लेन यू द पेपर फॉर्मेट ऑफ द ज्योग्राफी 10th स्टैंडर्ड बोर्ड एग्जाम. आउट ऑफ 80 मार्क्स योर 10 मार्क्स विल बी फॉर मैप, दैट इज द इंडिया मैप यू ऑल हैव. 20 marks would be for topography, which we haven't started yet. And 50 marks would be theory. Out of that 50 marks, y'all will be getting 9 questions. There are 9 chapters in history, and each and every chapter will have one 10 marks question. And out of that 9, you have to attempt any 5. Okay? So this Transport in India is the easiest chapter of geography. Everyone has to attempt this chapter because the questions asked in the boards are also easy and they are basic, and the chapter is really very basic. In Transport of India, we'll be studying about the 3 major transport modes, that is roadways, second is airways, and next is the railways. And we'll be studying the advantages and disadvantages of each and everyone, and what is the importance of transport in India. Let's start. What is the importance of transport? First, it helps, enables means helps the quick movement of people and goods from place to place. Okay, easy. That if you want to transfer goods from a place to another place, it is all because of transport. Next, the availability of various modes of transport gives a boost to the agricultural growth. By how does it boost up the agricultural growth? Because agricultural fields in India are far away from the markets, okay, and also from the industries. So the raw materials are delivered to the industry and market only because of the transportation, and that too by providing the fast connectivity between the manufacturing area where the goods have been made, that is the industries, and the markets. That is the second point. Third, during the calamities, okay, for example, we had a calamity last year in Kerala. So if there is a calamity in Kerala, so to deliver food, medicines, clothes over there, relief measures over there, so it is only possible because of the transport. So good network of transport comes in handy, means it's very important for effective rescue and relief operation in times of natural or the man-made calamities. That to rescue them means to save them, and relief operation means to give them all the resources which they need. So we have completed the first answer, that what is the importance of transport system. First, quick movement. Second one was it is giving a boost to the agricultural growth. And third is, during calamities, it is proving to be a boon that all the rescues and relief operation has been done through transport. Okay, so you all have to mark the keywords, that is first is calamities, here is agricultural produce, and here is the movement. Let's start with the first type of transport, that is the roadways. Now here we'll be studying what are the advantages of the roadways in India. It is the cheapest mode of transport in comparison to railways and the airways. So first advantage of roadways is it is very cheap. Second, it is comparatively easy to construct roads even in the remote areas. What do you mean by remote areas? That is the inside areas, village areas, which are far away from the main roads. So it is easy to construct. Third main important point, that roadways provide door-to-door transport services and saves lot of time. See, in case of railways and airways, it is not possible to reach each and every house, that to reach each and every door, but through roadways it is possible to reach each and everywhere. It is, we can reach in every corner of the world because railway lines are fixed wherever they are, but from the railways where it has been unloaded to bring it to the houses, it is only possible because of the roads. So the most important point is door-to-door services. So we have completed advantages. What are the three advantages? First, door-to-door services. Second, very cheap. And third, all the remote areas can be connected through this. And also the rugged means rough. Terrain means the area. High altitudes where rail network cannot be provided. In the hilly slopes, in the mountains, where the transport, only road transport is available, because on the hilly regions it is not possible to construct the railway lines. So there only road transport is available, where on the high altitudes, on the mountains. So see, now while doing the advantages of roadways, the type of question which is asked in boards is like they ask in the comparative way, that how is roadways more convenient in case of railways, or how roadways is convenient in comparison to airways. So in that way you have to compare the advantages and disadvantages, and then you'll have to write. So definitely roadways is cheap, then railways and airways is very expensive to construct. Roadways can be constructed on the mountains, but it's not possible to construct the airways and the railways. And also door-to-door facilities only possible through the roadways and not through the railways or the airways. But there are some disadvantages also. Now what are those disadvantages? Road transport is not suitable for long distance transport. Whenever the journey is long, it is not possible. Why so? See, y'all can roam in railways. In railway compartments, y'all can sleep. We can sleep. We can roam wherever we want. We can stretch ourselves. But in case of road transport, where we are in a car or a bus, it's not possible to stretch. So it is not suitable for long distance transport. This is a disadvantage. But when we have to do a long journey, only railway or roadway is possible. So here what will be the question, that how is railways and airways more convenient in comparison to roadways? So the first point will be that road transport is not suitable for long distance journey, whereas rail and air is suitable for the long distance journey. Let's move on. For bulk transport, bulk means heavy, lots of materials are there. So bulk, huge in quantity means bulk. Whenever there is a bulk transport, roadways are more expensive than railways and waterways. See, there are so many compartments in railways. We can store lots of amount, lots of quantity of goods in that. But in roadways, that is in cars and buses, there's a restricted amount of space, and therefore the bulk, huge amount of quantity to be transported is not possible. Third, rapid rise in the number of road vehicles is the chief factor for increasing air pollution and traffic congestion. So there is lots of pollution which is degrading the quality of air and harming us, in the form of we are having respiratory diseases and breathing problems, and so many other diseases is there, because of which roadways is not an advantage to our country, because it is causing pollution. Okay, so we have completed three answers. First one was the importance of transport system, second the advantages of roadways, and third is the disadvantages of the roadways. Now next, there are three types of roads. First is the national highway, second is the state roads, and then the district roads. Now what are the meanings of these three? For example, on the map of India, you all can see, this is, here it is Mumbai, this is Jaipur. Now the roads which join all the major cities of India, that comes under the national highway. For example, if I zoom this one, I'll be seeing a road over here starting from Mumbai, Surat, Ahmedabad, and then Udaipur. So that is a national highway. If I zoom in, I get, for example, Pali or Sirohi. So the road going from Udaipur, you can see the pencil mark, from the road which is going from Udaipur to Sirohi, that will be called as a state road. Okay, now if I zoom in more, in Sirohi I get मेनी रोड्स फ्रॉम सिरोही टू पिंडवारा और मोर इन सिरोही विच कनेक्ट्स सिरोही टू द गोयली दैट कम्स अंडर द डिस्ट्रिक्ट रोड्स. आई रिपीट वंस अगेन ऑल द रोड्स दैट द रोड जॉइनिंग द मेजर सिटीज ऑफ इंडिया दैट इज फ्रॉम मुंबई टू उदयपुर दैट कम्स अंडर द नेशनल हाईवे. When I zoom in, when the roads which are connected to the national highway and which takes in inside the city, for example, Udaipur to Sirohi, that is the state roads. And from Sirohi to a smaller village, for example, Pindwara or Nana, that comes under the district roads. Okay, so let's start. This national highways are handled by the central government. They run through the length and breadth of the country and connect all the state capitals and the major cities, ports and airports. Okay, so the roads which connect all the major cities, that is known as the National Highway, and it is under the National Highway Authorities of India, which was set up in the year 1988 and which is responsible for the development, maintenance, operation and management of these roads. Okay, so these are the national highway. Now there's two types of major national highways. First is the golden quadrilateral. See, this is the golden quadrilateral on the map of India. This there's a road joining the major cities of India, that is New Delhi, Kolkata, Chennai and Mumbai. This blue color line, there's a straight road over here, and the road which joins these major four cities, this is known as the golden quadrilateral. Okay, so you can see New Delhi, Maharashtra, Chennai, Kolkata, and this is the Bangalore over here. Bangalore is over here. Here is in the Karnataka. Okay, so it is joining the four major cities. It is the biggest expressway project announced in 1999. It is 5,846 km long, 4 to 6 lane highway network. What do you mean by four way? See, this is the four way roads where at a time two cars can go and the other two roads on the either side. Okay, so these are the four lane roads, and there are also six lane roads on the golden quadrilateral. There are 4 to 6 lane highway network connecting the 4 metropolitan cities of India, that is Delhi, Kolkata, Chennai and Mumbai. It was built by the NHAI under the banner of National Highway Development Project. Okay, coming on to the next page, that is state highways. As I had mentioned, example, this is Mumbai, this is Udaipur. The road joining the major cities is the national highway, and the road which is connected to the national highway, this road is the state highways. Okay, so these are constructed and maintained by the respective state governments. They provide connectivity between the national highways. See, they are connected to the national highways and district headquarters. So these are the state highways. Next is the district road. Now district roads are connected to the state highways, which takes us inside the cities and connects all the small villages. These are the important roads which are connected within a district. They connect the district headquarters to taluk headquarters. They also connect the areas of production in the district to the nearby markets, and they are maintained by the district administration. Next type of road is the border roads. On the map of India, all the these black lines, the dark black lines, are the border roads which are maintained by the Border Road Organization, that is the BRO, because these borders are connected with the other countries, that is China, Pakistan, and we do not have a good relation with those countries. So the India is on the continuous war with them. So these roads are of strategic importance, where defense is a vital for our Indian economy. So therefore, considering the safety of our India, these roads are managed by independent organization known as the BRO. So these roads are also known as the border road areas. Border roads, these are built and managed by the Border Road Organization, that is the BRO. The main purpose of this road is to enhance, that is develop, our defense preparedness, that whenever there is a war, quickly the army can be reached over there. Preparedness and the economic development of the border areas. And also, apart from the roads, BRO also undertakes the construction of bridges and airfields in these areas. Snow clearance. Since these areas are on the higher altitudes, there's snow all over. So to clear the snow is also the responsibility of the BRO in high altitude roads. Okay, moving on to the next page. Advantages of railways. What are the advantages? Easy and quick transport in comparison to road. Railways are always quick. Second, it also enables quick and efficient relief work. Once again, we are on this point that relief, whenever there is a disaster, man-made or natural, all the relief work can be provided in terms of food, shelter, money, each and medicines. It can be reached through railways in a quick span of time. That relief work can be given on a large scale during the natural calamities through railways. Third point is, it is the most comfortable, as I had mentioned, that railways is the most comfortable. Why? Because we can stretch ourselves. Okay, we can roam also, but in case of roadways, in car, it is not possible. So therefore, it provides the most comfortable and cost effective long distance transport for people across the country, and also it is cost effective. It's not so costly, it is little cheap. So this is the advantages of railways. So we'll repeat. First, material can be transported quickly. Second, relief work can be given quickly in the areas of calamities. And third, it is comfortable journey and cost effective also. But there are some disadvantages. First, the railways lack the flexibility. In case of roadways connect in roadways, it is possible to reach door-to-door services. The door-to-door services can be given, but in case of railways, it is not possible. So it lacks the flexibility of routes. And also, it is difficult to lay railway line in the uneven terrain. Uneven means rough, which is uneven. Terrain means land. But roadways can be built, and therefore, in the mountainous region, roadways is possible. Second, long distance rail transport is more time consuming and tedious in comparison to air transport. When I compare railways with the airways, railways is time consuming because we have to follow long distance, okay, through which it takes lots of time. We have to cross all the mountains, all the barriers, so it takes lots of time. But in case of air transport, there are no barriers, no mountains. Easily we can reach to the next continent, the continent also. So railways provide long distance, becomes more time consuming and also tedious in comparison to the air transport. It causes great noise pollution. Trains that run on coal and diesel cause lots of air pollution. In comparison to airways, the pollution in railways is more. So disadvantage we have done. First disadvantage, lack of flexibility. Second is, it becomes tedious and more time consuming. And third, it causes lots of air pollution. Next concept is gauge. See, there are three types of gauge: broad gauge, meter and narrow. What is a gauge? See, the distance between the railway lines is known as a gauge. So when the distance is about 1.676 meters, it is known as a broad gauge. This image is of a broad gauge. Okay. Basically, all the gauges in India, around 75%, India follows this broad gauge only. Okay, so this is a broad gauge. Its distance is 1.67 meters. Konkan Railways. You know, there can be a question asked over here. Konkan Railways is known as the engineering marvel of India. I repeat, Konkan Railways is known as the engineering marvel. Marvel means wonder. I repeat, Konkan Railways is known as the engineering marvel of India. Marvel means wonders, because Konkan Railways connects Roha in Maharashtra to Mangalore in Karnataka. See, if I show you the map of India, this is the map of India. Okay, here is Mangalore. Okay, and you can see Roha over here. Roha, सो फ्रॉम रोहा फ्रॉम रोहा अप टिल फ्रॉम रोहा टू मैंगलोर इंडियन रेलवेज हैज़ कंस्ट्रक्ट अ लाइन विच कनेक्ट्स रोहा एंड मैंगलोर सी इन बिटवीन दिस देयर कम्स गोवा वेर देर लॉट्स ऑफ वाटरफॉल्स देयर इज अ ग्रीनरी इन मैंगलोर देर आर वेस्टर्न घाट्स ओवर हियर एंड देन टू द इंडियन रेलवेज हैज़ कंस्ट्रक्ट अ रेलवे लाइन विच कनेक्ट्स रोहा टू मैंगलोर सो देयरफॉर इट इज कंसिडर्ड एज द इंजीनियरिंग मार्वल दैट इट इज बिल्ड अप सच इट इज सच ब्यूटिफुल कंस्ट्रक्शन दैट इट गोज फ्रॉम द वैलीज फ्रॉम द हिल्स एंड एवरीथिंग सो देयरफॉर द कोंकण रेलवेज विच कनेक्ट्स The Roha and the Mangalore is considered to be the engineering marvel. Konkan Railways has always played a great role in the economic growth of the western coastal region. See, this is the West India and it is on the coast. So, the Konkan Railways has played an important role in the west coastal region from Maharashtra to Kerala. Now, next is the meter gauge. Where the distance between these lines is less, that is, here it was, earlier it was 1.67 meters. Here it is almost half, that is around 1 meter and 0.76 meter. It will be called as a meter and a narrow gauge. How does it look? See, something like this, where all the toy trains have been used. So they use all the meter and the narrow gauge. The distance between the rail is 1 meter over here and narrow it is 0.76 meters. And it is used only in the hilly regions for the toy trains and everything. Okay. Next is the waterways. What is the advantage of waterways? It is the cheapest mode of transport. It is ideal mode for transporting heavy and bulky goods. Why it is cheapest mode? Because it does not involve any construction of railway line, okay, or construction of any road. So it becomes the cheapest mode of transport. And it is ideal mode of transporting heavy and bulky goods. See, ships are huge in size. So, more quantity of goods can be stored in comparison to the roadway. So, it is an ideal mode to transport all the heavy and the bulky goods. Third, it is safe and has less traffic in comparison to road and the rail transport. It's obvious, it is the most easiest point that in case of waterways, there is no traffic problem which we face in the roadways. Disadvantages of the waterways. Since it is totally depend on the weather condition, so it becomes a disadvantage. Bad weather can overturn the vessels, so at that time the transportation through waterways is not possible. Second, it needs long traveling hours and hence also time consuming. Many of the Indian ports are not well connected by roads and railways, thus increasing the cost of inland transport and hinterland connectivity. What do you mean by hinterland? The land which is away from the sea is known as a hinterland. Now, what is this point actually? See, this is India. Majorly, the ports are on the border areas, okay? On the border areas. So, if you want to deliver goods which is in the hinterland, that is away from the sea, for example, over here. So it requires at last road connectivity. So what is the overall point? That the waterways transport is not possible where you have to transport goods to the hinterland. At the end, you need the support of the roadways or the railways. So that is the point, that it increases the cost to bring till here the goods, and then again you have to pay for the road transport. So it increases the cost when there is inland transport and the hinterland connectivity, when you have to connect to the hinterlands, that is the inside areas. Okay, next page. Next are the major ports. You don't have to do Kolkata. Next is the Visakhapatnam port. It is the deepest landlocked harbor. Now, what do you mean by landlocked? Where there are land on all the three sides, it is known as the landlocked. And harbor means where the ships have been parked, where the parking of the ship is been done. See, I'll show you the Visakhapatnam. See on the map of India, here is the Visakhapatnam. You can see Visakhapatnam over here. Here is the Visakhapatnam, which is in Andhra Pradesh. And this is the view of the Visakhapatnam port. It is said that it is the deepest landlocked harbor. See, it starts from here and it goes inside up to kilometers. So hence it is the deepest landlocked harbor, because it is covered by land on both the sides, from almost all, from all the sides, and therefore it is called as a landlocked because it's covered from the land, and deepest because the ships can travel up till here. The water level is high over here, and harbor means where the ships are been kept or been parked. It handles mainly the crude oil and to other petroleum products. Basically all the crude oil manufacturing is been sent over here from the ships, and it has been delivered over here, the crude oil and the petroleum products. Next is the Chennai port. It is the artificial port on the eastern coast. Artificial means we have made, okay? And Visakhapatnam is generally a natural port. It is natural. We have not constructed it, but in case of Chennai port, the Indian government has constructed that port. Now connecting to Chennai port is the Ennore port. All the traffic on the Chennai port is too much because lots of loading process is carried on over there. So to reduce the workload, they have built an Ennore port also. See, you can see on the map of India, here it is Chennai, and close to Chennai there is a Ennore port over here. So since there's lots of traffic over here, so the remaining loading process has been done on the Ennore port. So to reduce the congestion over here, the Ennore port was built. It is a newly developed port in Tamil Nadu, situated about 25 km north of Chennai. You can see, if you go north from Chennai, you find the Ennore port. The main purpose of this port was to decongest, to remove the congestion of the Chennai port. Okay. Next is the Mumbai port. It is the biggest natural harbor of India. As we had studied over here, the Chennai port was the artificial port, because we had made it, the Indian government has made, but Mumbai is the natural port. There was no need of construction, and it was been there from many years ago. The Mumbai port is the biggest natural harbor of India. It handles about 1/5 of the total seaport traffic. So the quantity of amount which has been unloaded, out of that 1/5 of the goods have been unloaded at the Mumbai port. It has the country's largest oil terminal to handle the petroleum products imported from the Middle East countries. Okay, so all from the foreign countries, whatever oil products have been coming, it has been unloaded at the Mumbai port. Next is the Jawaharlal Nehru port. It is the Nava Sheva near Mumbai port. It was developed to decongest the Mumbai port in the same way where there was Chennai, and to reduce the loading process, we built on the Ennore port. Same way, to reduce the congestion of the Mumbai, Jawaharlal Nehru port was been constructed. Next is the Kochi port, natural harbor, and what all things it exports, that is tea, coffee, spices, and the imports and petroleum and the fertilizers. And coming on to the last topic for the day, that is the air transport. Now air transport has been handled by the Airports Authority of the India. What are the advantages of air transport? It is the fastest mode of transport among all the transport in comparison to roadways and the railways. Second, it can easily overcome the transport barriers. I mentioned that all the rivers, mountains, all the barriers can be easily overcome through the air transport, such as the mountains, valleys and the rivers. It is of the utmost significance in terms of natural calamities, that during natural calamities the foods, medicines and the other facilities can be easily been delivered over there, such as floods and earthquakes. During the time of floods and earthquakes, to undertake the relief and the rescue operation, air transport is the best. So what are the 3 points? Fastest mode, definitely the quickest mode of transport. Second, it doesn't have any barriers like rivers or mountains, and it can easily fly and cross all the barriers. And third, during the natural calamities, due to air transport, all the relief measures can be easily provided, delivered. But there are some disadvantages also. It is the most expensive mode of transport, the costliest. It is depend upon the weather condition, but in case of roadways, it is not depend on the weather condition. Third, it requires superior technical engineering skills. And if any mistake directly leads to too many deaths, any lapse in the direction can cause air crashes, resulting in the disastrous consequences. Okay, so most expensive, weather condition depends on the air transport is depend upon the weather conditions, and third, the skills required for the air transport is technical in nature. And the last concept for the day, that is the Pavanhans. What do you mean a Pavanhans? Pavanhans is the helicopter services in India. For example, it is a Mumbai over here, land. See, for example, there's a mining industry or there's oil and refinery industries over here. So to take the labors from the industry over here on the land and to once again give the facility to the labors to reach over here, it is done through the helicopters. Okay. See, it is air logistic and transport for the offshore operation. What do you mean by offshore? Away from the shore operation. Away from the shore, there are activities, oil and refinery activities being done. So to bring the labors over here and to get back them is done through the helicopters. Okay, and it is also used in the hilly region. For example, in the Vaishno Devi, where it is very time consuming to go through any other means of transport. So through helicopters, all the tourists have been helped to reach over there through the helicopters. And this concept of helicopter is carried on by the Pavanhans Helicopters Limited of India. Okay, so we have completed the chapter. If any doubts you all have, you all can contact me on personally, or you can ask me on my WhatsApp number. Okay, so very soon start learning, and very soon I'll be giving test of geography. Thank you.